Brothers and sisters, I am honored to be here with you on the 50th anniversary of this pilgrimage of peace at Christmas time, and I'm especially honored to receive your Peace Award. It is so strange that as I accept your award, I feel very much in a compromised position, like Obama. I'm not sure that I deserve it. I am not the foremost person in the movement. I mean, I've only been to prison one or two times. I've only been called an inconvenience to military action several times. Not yet earth-shattering action. So I received this, and especially since Obama received his award after having given 30,000 more troops a surge in Afghanistan than he has going to receive a peace award. Just the other night on the Jim Lehrer News Hour, I was saying that maybe Obama gave a valid speech and that maybe he's a principled pragmatic and that we hope he's going to be a leader that is called a peace president, but that whether that's going to happen, since he listens to both sides, will be determined by whether or not we make sure that we are heard with respect to our commitment. Amen. We cannot turn our president over to those who will claim him for hawkish activities or for sustaining the military-industrial complex. We have that responsibility, and I want to begin by saying for many years I specialized in critiquing adversaries of peace. Now it is clear to me that if you do that long enough, you take on yourself the position of victimization. We who are in this movement may be victims of first one force and another, but the cause to which we have committed ourselves means that we are conquerors, at least in our own idea, except that the world doesn't know it yet. And we have a responsibility to mobilize, to strengthen ourselves, to clarify what we're about, and to get ready to get on the road again so we begin our next 50 years of championing the cause of peace. Well, so much for preliminary conversation. I've been asking people how long my talk should be, and I am very much aware that you have been walking from 12 o'clock to 5 o'clock, and that if anybody is going to sleep tonight, it won't be because I'm so dull, it's just that you're tired. So at least that suggests that if I have anything worthwhile saying, I better get on with it while I gather the last portion of your attentive message for today. You see printed in the bulletin that my topic is get on the path and stay on the path. That's what came to my mind when I received the 10th call from Mimi Lane, making sure that I was going to be here tonight. And what is the topic going to be? And it occurred to me that because you have been walking all day, that it would be important for me to say that walk was actually a down payment on the walk you're called upon to do beyond this night. And so I want to drag out of the past a poem I wrote just entitled, Get on the Path. And I want to teach you at least the chorus of it, because that's the way I plan to end my sermon. So, here's the way it goes. It says, and usually, when we close the sermon, I will ask you who have been walking all day long to walk some more. I'll ask you to stand up, and even though it'll appear that you're in place, I'll ask you to walk, and the words I will be using, get on the path, get on the path, get on the path, I'll meet you there. Let's get on the path and stay on the path. that's what I'm going to do. So we might as well practice that. I would get going. I really get fast sometimes. And we won't have time to teach it as we come to the end. So will you just repeat these words as best you can? First of all, get on the path.
Get on the path.
Get on the path.
I'll meet you there.
Let's get on the path.
And stay on the path.
The Lord will meet us there. Try one more time.
Get on the path. Get on the path.
Get on the path.
I'll meet you there.
Let's
get on the path.
And stay on the path.
The Lord will meet us there.
Fine. When we get to the end, you'll know your words, and I'll add some to it. Well, it is true that to be able to really promote the cause of peace, one must, as the song that you already sang tonight suggests, that peace is not just a static state of non-combat, but it is a path with campgrounds of contentment on the way to the ultimate peace we dream about. Henri Nouwen was right. Peace is the way. It is not just getting to the place. It's going and traveling and marching on the way to peace. I think it is important for those of us who are champions of peace to keep before our eyes what the celestial city looks like towards which we are marching. What will peace look like if we ever get there? And so I want to share tonight my favorite peace passage. I've chosen it because it gives us images of what peace looks like when we finally get there. But it also alerts us to what may block our vision of what peace is as we journey toward it. And also, this passage that I'm going to share with you says something about how imagination can enable us to work with God in the pursuit of peace. So I'm going to be working with this text. And as I read this text, I want you, even before I get to try it out myself, to be thinking, what are the images here that give some sense of what peace might look like? Or what is at work in this text that may alert us to what the barriers are, or the blinders, what actually blocks a clear vision of peace? And also in this text that I'm getting ready to read to you, what is it that shows us that we will really consent to a season of imaginative reflection, how we might become partners again and again with God's plan to bring peace on earth?